Please come to order. There's a board present, all the members are present, the board's really full. Is there a motion to open court? All those in favor?
Aye.
Bill, please open court.
All rise. That is going to the first court is now in session for May 2013 term with the Honorable Judge Bacon presiding. Please remain standing for the invocation.
And our invocation today will be given by guest commissioners.
Yes, Judge, colleagues, members of the audience, our pastor speaking today is Jose Aaron Hernandez, which today is also joined by his two grandsons. Reverend, can you please come forward? Reverend Jose Aaron Hernandez is the founder and senior pastor of Templo de Dios Viviente Church for 22 years. He attended the Instituto Biblico Betania, Biblico Alpha Omega, and Assemblies of God Bible College in Mexico City. He has talent for singing and has recently recorded a second CD in Spanish. They reside in North Oak Cliff. He has been married for 40 years to his wife, Yolanda Hernandez, who is also a pastor at Templo de Dios Viviente. They have three grown children, Pearl Hernandez, Joe Aaron Hernandez, and Christy Michelle Hernandez. They also have three grandchildren, Daniel, Adrian, Rhea, Christopher Michael, Rhea, and baby Mateo Aaron Cardenas. Thank you, Reverend, for being with us this morning. Thank you. Pray.
I only bow my head, please, in the name of Jesus. Almighty God, who is worthy of all the honor, the glory, and the praise, I thank you this morning for the opportunity you have given me to come before your holy presence in the name of your only Son, Jesus Christ, and present the County Commissioner Court meeting. I pray your Holy Spirit guide in them and all the decisions and business they will be confirmed today. Trust in this county will be conducted in a fair and impartial way with honesty and justice. We pray for Mr. Maureen Dickey, Mike Contrell, County Judge Clay Jenkins, Jan Wyatt Price, and Dr. Elba Garcia. They who are now in authority of the Dallas County hold this position because you, God, have allowed it. Bless, use them in such a way they will be a living testimony for others to come. Give them a sound heart and judgment in all the decisions that they need to make. I'm asking, Lord, in your name and the name of Jesus Christ, your only Son, we give it the glory, the honor, and we praise it forever. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
We have some resolutions for it, and I will read it, move for its adoption. All over here, please come forward to accept the resolution. And anyone who wants. And the resolution reads as follows. Whereas the American Cancer Fund for Children and Kids Cancer Connection report cancer is the leading cause of death by disease among U.S. children between infancy and age 15, with 46 children being diagnosed with cancer each day. This tragic disease is detected in nearly 15,000 of our country's young people each and every year. And whereas 1 in 300 children will develop cancer by age 20, and 1 in 5 of our nation's children loses his or her battle with cancer once contracted. Many infants, children, and teens will suffer from long-term effects of comprehensive treatment, including secondary cancers. And whereas founded 20 years ago by Stephen Farson, a member of the philanthropic Max Factor family, the American Cancer Fund for Children, Inc., and Kids Cancer Connection are dedicated to helping children and families. The Whereas the American Cancer Fund for Children and Kids Cancer Connection provide a variety of viable patient psychosocial services to children undergoing cancer treatment. The Medical City Children's Hospital, Children's Medical Center in Dallas, as well as participating hospitals throughout the country, thereby enhancing the quality of life of these children and their families. Whereas the Cancer Fund for Children, Kids Cancer Connection also sponsor nationwide Courageous Kid Recognition Award ceremonies and hospital celebrations in honor of child determination and bravery to fight the battle against childhood cancer. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Dallas County does hereby proclaim the week of May 26th to June 1st, 2013, the Childhood Cancer Awareness Week in Dallas County, and encourages all residents to participate and support in this effort. All right, motion carries unanimously. Mr. O'Rear, I know you have a personal stake in this, and I want you to know that this resolution is presented by this court in our city's memory. If you would like to say a few words, please go ahead.
Thank you, Judge Jenkins, and good morning, commissioners. First of all, I want to express my personal appreciation to the Dallas County Commissioners Court for issuing this resolution. My daughter Ashley was 9 years old. She was diagnosed with a malignant brain tumor. And suddenly my family was thrown into a world that prior to that we really didn't even know existed, the world of pediatric cancer. That world became a very real part of our lives from that point forward. And we realized that there are thousands of children all over the world who are fighting for their lives every day against this monster that we call cancer. Ashley lost her battle to cancer in 2001 at the age of 14. But today there are still thousands of children in the fight. Next year there will still be thousands of children fighting for their lives. 5 years from now there will still be thousands of children struggling to survive their battle with pediatric cancer. Anything that we can do to bring to the world's attention their plight is a good thing. And so this morning on behalf of Chairman Stephen Feierstein and the American Cancer Fund for Children and Kids Cancer Connection, once again, I thank you for issuing this proclamation. God bless you.
God bless you. Sir, let's take a moment out of prayer for the our neighbors in Oklahoma. Prayer or a moment of silence. Thank you all. Let me take a moment. If you could, this morning I had the opportunity to receive a call from Jim Kidd, who is our state's emergency manager, and I had some information for our citizens. And actually, I'm jotting those down as I speak here for a second, so I'm not sure I remember everything Jim told me, because it is information I want to get out to you today about Oklahoma, our neighbors are on your mind, and your children, your families are on your mind. So here are four things that we would ask that you consider doing. So the first thing is you can buy a weather radio. Weather radios are available in the Dallas Fort Worth area at Radio Shack, CVS, Walgreens, most grocery stores, Lowe's, and Home Depot. They cost about $30. They're relatively easy to program, and they are life-saving, important equipment, important devices, as important for your family as the radio, as the flashlight, and a lot of more. We recommend that those of you who desire to have one, go get one. The second thing is, it's important, of course, as we talk about all the time, to have a tornado plan. And the simplest aspects of that plan are, in situations of bad weather, get low. Do not be on the second floor. Be as low as possible. If you have a basement, get in there. If you don't have a basement, be on the first floor and put as many walls between you and the windows as you can. Get to an interior room, preferably a bathroom with plumbing and piping. Have water and your weather radio and a flashlight in the room. Be dressed appropriately with strong shoes in case you have to go outside. Third, and this is specific to Oklahoma, obviously our hearts go out to our neighbors in Oklahoma and we want to do something. We want to send resources or perhaps we want to go and help in the search and rescue efforts. We would ask that you please do not go to Oklahoma. The site is pancaked, it is moving, it is extremely dangerous. Non-trained professionals on site endanger the lives of the people that we're looking for, endanger the life of the first responders. Please don't go. Also, and this is somewhat counterintuitive, but please don't send resources right now. If you want to make donations to the Red Cross, Salvation Army, or your faith-based organizations, please do so. But please do not, organizations, send resources without coordinating through the first responder entities, because there's no place for the resources if you send them. Fourth, today we are going to experience some severe weather. And I know some people are very concerned about our children in schools. And there may be people that feel like if there's severe weather, I should go get my child. Please don't do that, all right? The schools here are built to a higher standard and a higher code than most houses are, almost all houses are. And the most unsafe place for your child in severe weather is traveling with you in a car if a tornado were to strike. So the school professionals have a plan. They have a place, shelter in place. The schools are safer buildings than houses. Do not go to the school, to interrupt school and try to get your child unless you're told to do so by a person in authority. That's information from your county and also from your state about the current state of weather emergency. We greatly appreciate it. If those of you in the media who are here, I know that's way too long to broadcast what I said, but banner those four things on the bottom of your broadcast if you would please. And that takes us to our next item, which is the consent agenda. So moved. Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. We will now consider item 9.
Water bids approved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. We will now consider. I've got order over 10 through 32 and A1, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right, take a motion on 10 through 32 and A1.
So moved.
Second.
Let's look at the substitute on the contract.
Oh, right.
26.
Right.
I gave
the
original price of the
correction. Right. It was 4 and 13. They were minor adjustments. 5.0 to 5.1 and 13, and the other one was the last sentence. So much. Second agrees.
Moved by Dr. Garcia, second by Commissioner Price, with the corrections on the contract 26. Right.
Right.
Any further discussion? Any further?
I just wanted to make some comments. You know, first of all, I want to thank. You know, I think I saw Ron's scripture and Mike Pianza here, and I think I remember from you. Thank you. Thank you for everything you do when it comes to permanent supporting housing. The plan developed will go to the Dallas City Council, and hopefully we'll have, you know, the plan. Thank you so much for all your work, and I understand this has been great also in the behavioral health of the people. My colleagues will be great, and if you have without you guys. So thank you so much for your work. And an agenda item number 32, I just want to thank, you know, it's like every week I have to thank Alberta Mayor and her staff for the fantastic job that they're doing, you know, with the Hunter Federal program. The money that we put in agenda item number 32, those $77,000, are to complete the Bell Line to McCartney pedestrian park. So I look forward to finish this project and hopefully, you know, it'll be taken care of by the county. anymore. So, with that being said, thank you, Ms. Blair, thank you to you and your staff.
Judge, based on that same person, I also want to thank Mr. Stretch and Ms. Franza and all of them, part of not only the DHLT, Dr. Daniels, my coach here, with regards to this whole thing of permanent supportive housing. It's been a long time coming, Mike. I know you were imported back to perform this task, and you performed well. Seems like only 3 years ago you were sitting down talking about this. But nonetheless, thank you. Thank you very much for your leadership in this area. I like Dr. Garcia, and I want to thank all of my colleagues for being there last week as we book in the southern sector with the real twin bridges. You know, Dallas has got something called we got the real signature bridges and Southern Dallas, Wintergreen Road, we did a couple of years ago. And on last week, we basically about 10 months away from Pleasant Run. And it will make all the difference in probably the best intermodal area in this country by any stretch of the imagination. Third of the top interstates, third of the top 10 interstates in the country run through the southern sector. With that and what this court has embraced, I just want to say thank you on behalf of not only the citizens of Southern Dallas, but all of Dallas, as we will hear from Ken Nolan here in a minute. We're going to be able to make a real contribution to the tax base.
I would only like to add that coming lately to this court, it's with great excitement that I see these projects that have been in the works coming forward. And would only like to add, we're not done yet, and we're in great excitement seeing what is coming up. So thank you, Mr. for all your efforts, and we've got some exciting things coming up in Dallas County that will be good for all of the county.
You know, most of us have pinned slogans like, you know, I'm in downtown. I got one, just one, but not done yet. I like that. I've heard that about 50,000 times now. We're not done yet. District one, we're not done yet.
Well, hopefully, Commissioner, we're really, really close to this time. You know, I know that we, you know, when my fiance, I just came to God and said, gosh, I really want to say, you know, like, when I met Don Stretcher, and when we start working with all these different groups, you know, for the betterment of the, you know, housing and mental health. So I know that you are an important component with many other elected officials, and that's the beauty of it, that we can work together.
But he was here, and so for history, it would be correct. He was here, and he left, yeah, and then he returned.
That's right.
Yeah, he returned.
And came home.
Came home. Right.
Couldn't deal with that.
Stay away. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
Church. Yeah, I want to give a shout out to Mike Fianza. There are a few people that really care about the homeless, and none more than he do. And it is, but I've said this before, and looking for ways to, you know, pay God back for blessings. We debate sometimes up here about how to handle the mosquito problem. And yeah, I can't look in my Bible and find the answer to mosquitoes. And I can't find the answer in my Bible to trails or, you know, tax incentives. But gosh, you can almost open to any page, and you can see what God has to say about taking care of the poor and the homeless. And so I think what you do is just so important for our community, and it's something that I think this court pretty much uniformly has a passion for helping with. I see sitting next to you and around you members of our philanthropic community, and I think the newspaper, somebody's, I did a story this week that our philanthropic community is ranked number one in the country. I talked to somebody yesterday and said, what are the assets around here? You know, trying to lure people here. And one of the things I talked about is we got a great philanthropic community. There's a little bit of concern with this person about the dearth of services that perhaps Texas provides compared to other places. I said, we've got a great, you know, philanthropic community, but we've got pretty vibrant social services here, supplemented by that philanthropic community. Sure, I was spending trying to get somebody to move here, but it is true. You guys do a tremendous job. I think part of the social fabric of Dallas County, a huge part of it, is the work of the philanthropic community. I want to recognize one of the commissioners, and that's Commissioner Price. On those bridges, I was out there waiting for the bridge opening. And, you know, right now, of course, we're just digging up dirt right now, getting ready to get that started. But you look in front of you, all you see is containers. There's containers, you know, you get that intermodal port. Inside that intermodal port, there's a manufacturing plant where they're manufactured housing, and it's just stacked up as far as the eye can see. What that means is tax base. And we're seeing tremendous tax base there. A man came up to me, Mayor Pro Tem of Wilmer, and he was excited. He said, Judge, as far as I know, Legacy Bank doesn't have a branch south of 30, but they just joined our chamber. And people are beginning to notice the southeast portion of Dallas, all of Southern County, but particularly that neglected, non-urban, southeast portion of Dallas County that will be an economic driver equal to any other section of Dallas in the coming years. And the successes we're seeing there because of the vision of people over the last, you know, 10 or 15 years on work on this, they're exponential. So 2 weeks ago, we had a 250 employee plant open, and it barely raised the river. You know, 5 years ago, we had Whirlpool open. We had 400 employees or something. Big news. Now we're popping up in these 300 and 400 new job plants, and it's barely a ripple because they're happening so fast. And it's a testament to business, and it's a testament to private investment. But Commissioner Price, it's also a testament to you and others who worked on that before we got here. You know, we were able to jump on to a team that was already aiming in that direction and just help to keep pushing in that direction. So thanks for your work on that.
Well, I appreciate that. I want to take it again with this court. This court has made all the difference. You can aim if you want to, but if I need help hitting the target, this doesn't quite make it, and I'm just running down this court. That's
all right. All right, the question has been called. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, we'll now move to our briefing session.
And I noticed Ryan's got a new haircut. Is a doctor yet? Not yet. A little bit.
I'm slow on the uptake on that.
Right. All right.
This is our briefing session, which consists of items to be considered in a subsequent session. Our court administrator is recovering at home this week after an injury. Thoughts and prayers are with him. But he's a tough guy, and he's going to be fine. He's going to be back. He is ably represented by his second command board of people. Court, will you lead us through that briefing session today?
Thank you. Good morning, Judge. Good morning, Commissioners. The first item in the briefing agenda, presentation by Mr. Ken Nolan and the county's preliminary certified property tax.
Should we break into Oh Happy Day?
No, this is one where you break out the first leaves.
Mr. What's
go ahead and take us through that one. I think they're probably going to be pretty interested, Ken, so take a minute and go ahead and put your PowerPoint on. It's not just us, it's also the public. 10 as a trial lawyer, I completely understand the situation in your court. Something magical about being a trial lawyer.
Everybody who has the presentation is out. So,
if we can, we can move on to the other items for the back. We were in the process of the tree.
Unless anyone can do that problem. Whatever you think, Jen, if it's a problem, it's easier to...
You have a copy of it in front of you, you know?
Yeah.
Okay.
Leah, perhaps you could send it to me or report sheet.
I will. I'll be glad to. It's that time of year again. As you know, we've recently completed our reappraisal and sent out notices. And I want to talk about the three major property types we have to cover: residential, commercial, and business personal property. Let me start with residential. We reappraised a little bit over 236,000 residential properties this year. That's about 37% of the total in Dallas County. It's about 1,605 neighborhoods, which is about 33% of the total neighborhoods we have. We also look at all mobile homes every year. It's almost 12,000. Building permits, we had 2,896 new construction residential permits this year, 13% increase over 2012. And as far as miscellaneous permits, remodels, things of that nature, we had almost 34,000 this past year. That's a 49% increase over 2012. So things are starting to pick up again. We're certainly not back to the levels as far as new construction we were in 2006, 2007, but it's starting to work its way back. As I said, we did about 237,000 pieces of property this year reappraisal. Here's what we know. As I said, new construction is up for 2012. Foreclosures are becoming less and less of a factor this year over last year and over 2 years ago. We've seen values in residential flat to slightly up in the northern sector, flat to slightly up in the southern sector. Last couple of years we have not seen that. Last year, for example, when we were done, residential values countywide went down about 1.2%. That's not the case this year. Values are up in residential. Now granted, the residential market is not caught up with the commercial market. But it's starting to. As we get further and further along in 2013, we're seeing more and more sales and more increases in prices. So I think 2014 will be even better still as far as homes are concerned. At the end of the day, residential will be probably flat to slightly up down the line. As I said, last year it was slightly down. As I said, 2014 is going to see even better results, I think. Commercial, every year, as you know, Texas is not a sales disclosure state, so we can't do it the same way we do residential. So we work about one third of all our market areas every year. We also look at all the major property types every year: offices, warehouses, retail, apartments. And there's certain areas of the county, commercial wise, that are looked at every year: Central Business District, the LBJ Corridor, the Tollway, Las Colinas, things like that. Well, there's the market changes from year to year, so we can't neglect looking at those areas. And also, commercial properties represented by professional consultants, so we end up talking about all of it almost every year. New construction, there's 572 new construction starts in commercial. That's about the same as last year. But what's interesting is we had almost 4,800 miscellaneous permits. That's a 32% increase in 2012, which tells us a lot of existing property, they're going back in, remodeling, releasing it, which is a good thing for value at the end of the day. As I said, new construction is flat to slightly up. Redevelopment is way up, however. I said a lot of existing properties are being redeveloped. There's less uncertainty in the marketplace, in the commercial marketplace, than there was a couple of years ago. We've seen continued population and job growth, which equates to more leases, increased value. Rents and occupancies have stabilized or actually gone up in those cases. Most markets will see an increase in value. The apartment market, overall, when we reappraised, we raised apartments across the board somewhere between 20 and 30% in value. It's one of the hottest markets in Dallas County. Part of that is loans are still somewhat hard to come by on the residential side. Consequently, people are building apartments and rents are sky high, they're building a lot of apartments, occupancies are real high. Now, when the residential market comes back, as it always does, the apartment market will start to cool off again. And most of the product that's being built is Class A product that demands high rents, and it's a good quality product that will maintain its value over the years. As I said, the office market is on the upswing as well. Retail is still kind of hit and miss, depending on where it is, who your tenants are. There's still a lot of big box retail that's vacant until some new national companies come to this area, and we've frankly seen most of them. But you know, there's still some hope, and I think next year retail will probably do a little bit better than the future. Overall, commercial values in the county are up right now, preliminary, over 10%. In some cases, Addison, for example, they're up 15% to 18%. This is personal property. It's a little bit different. We look at every single account every year. We've got about 90,000 various types of business personal property accounts. As you know, you're required to render by law. We get about 65,000 renditions. We're real happy we get about 16,000 of those online, and that continues to increase every year. There's more things we can do online, more money we can save at the end of the day. And we have about 1,350 Freeport exemptions countywide that we have to process. This is personal property. The market value is slightly up for almost everyone in Dallas County. There's a continued trend in increasing capital investments as the economy gets better. People are going back in and reinvesting in their business. Most cities we visited when we did our budget visits this spring told us their sales tax was up, which means that typically means business personal property values would go up. Increased inventory, increased reinvestment. It usually tracks when sales tax gets up. Any increased tax incentives, however, will erode the taxable base. So the more abatements that are given, the more exemptions are given. That market value is not always necessarily transferred into taxable value at the end of the day. Overall, this is a personal property countywide to go up. At the end of the day, when we got done reappraising, countywide, there's 810,000 accounts. We saw value increases on 134,000 pieces of property. Value decreases on 157,000. No value changes on 517,000. And it tracks by property type. Residential had almost 87,000 homes that we raised values on this year. Last year it was only about 35,000. So you can see the market's coming back. And that's pretty well the trend has been countywide. Aha.
Yeah, I didn't get that copy. I don't know if anybody has it.
Okay.
So you can send it to us. I
really studied that.
No, I got mine. I got mine on the register for
That's the breakdown of what went up or went down by property value. Like I said, almost 9% value increases total, only 25% went down, 65% no value change. The ones that went up were high dollar class A commercial properties. And that makes a lot of difference value wise. Okay, next one. Okay, preliminary, there was an article in the newspaper that released the values, which we did last Thursday. I'm going to talk in terms of market value. The newspaper article came out and that Brian's on here, quote, it was taxable value. It's hard for me to, I usually look at market because taxable is dependent on how many people are going to come in and file for an exemption, how many people are going to get a Freeport exemption, how many people are going to get tax incentives. The market value is a truer indication of what's going on. You can see, go back. You can see countywide total market value was up 7.15%. Residential was up 2.13%. As I said last year, residential went down. Commercial property is up almost 14%. And again, we had some areas, Addison comes to mind, where their increase on commercial property was close to 20%. Business personal property was up 6.53%. You see in the city of Dallas, it was 8% increase, and DISD was 8.8% increase. And these are considerably higher. Last year was the first year we'd seen an increase in about 5 years. This is about three times higher than we saw last year. So things are getting better. Next one. Okay, notices, as I said, we sent out our first batch of notices back on April 26th. If you had an ownership change, you got a notice. If your value went up, you got a notice. If you for some reason you lost your homestead exemption, we notified you. All new accounts get notified. If you had a cap value, the homestead cap, you get a notice. If you rendered your account, if you had an authorized tax consultant, all business personal property accounts get a notice. In addition, there's a notice on the website, a PDF copy of the notice for every single account in Dallas County. So we will legally mail what we're required to, but if someone's curious, they can go on the website and see a notice whether their value didn't change, went down, whatever the case may be. We sent 153,000 residential notices, almost 29,000 commercial notices, 91,000 business personal property notices. We'll end up mailing almost 274,000 notices this year. Last year, we only mailed 236,000. Obviously, the difference is we had more values that went up. That's an increase of 37,000. Electronically, we've sent 43,500 notices, and that's an increase. Last year was the first year by law we were allowed to do electronic notices when we bring them to the taxpayer. I will tell you, that's increasing this year, and every time it increases, that's less postage we have to pay. It's a really good thing. As I said, our first mailing was April 26th. We had a second mailing on May 14th, our third mailing on May 28th. The big deadline of protest is next Friday, May 31st. The second deadline for protest is June 13th, and the third one for the third mailing is June 27th. We will finish and certify the roll no later than the legal deadline of July 25th, and hopefully early. I'm glad to answer any questions, or go back over the slides.
Kim, first of all, I continue to appreciate your service, and I think Dallas Vice Judge was talking a few months ago about philanthropic leadership. We've been blessed with a lot of good leadership around this state, from individuals and professionals like you. Dallas has always been one of those cities, counties that we've looked to with the best leadership in the Central Appraisal District area, so I appreciate that. Number two, I'm still having some trepidation with this kind of Jekyll Hyde deal with the southern sector. Because it's one thing when you deal with your values on paper, when you talk to developers in the southern sector, it doesn't quite meet out the same concerns. And again, this court and I, for the last several weeks, have had conversations about while we're seeing the businesses coming to the southern sector, we're seeing large abatements. And that has a different kind of impact. It's different when you begin to look at the bottom line. And I don't know if you would agree with me or disagree, but that appears to be what's going on south.
Yeah, there's, Lancaster came to mind. Their preliminary values were up a lot in commercial values. And it has to do, there's a lot of new construction due to what you talked about being on the port. But again, a lot of that has been abated to attract those people there. So it doesn't translate back to an increase in taxable value, at least for probably the next 10 years. I understand it's a necessary evil. Today's economy, business. If you don't do it, someone else is going to make them a better offer, be it Holland and Ellis County, whatever. And even if you, for example, if you abated the real estate, well, maybe the personal property didn't get abated, that gets taxed. It's just depending on what the deals were made. But at the end of the day, those only last 10 years, and hopefully, whatever business you've attracted is a long-term investment that will stay in the county for a period of 30, 40, 50 years. So. It's a two-edged sword, but it's the way things have to work.
And we've had that conversation here, and I think we recognize that we were trying to manage as best we can with regards to our cities. But needless to say, for those of us who've kind of been in the desert for so long, you may think it's a mirage, but it's like water to us, maybe 10 years.
I think, as I said, in 2014, as we go, our values are based on January 1 of 13, but as we have gone 5 months now into 14, we continue to see upticks, especially in residential, which the residential market's lagging behind the commercial market. And now we're starting to see, hear stories of people bidding on homes selling for more than list price. And those are the kind of things we saw back in the early 2000s when the residential market exploded. So obviously it's coming back. And then again, the commercial market just continues to grow. It's Texas and Dallas County is a good investment for people. They see that. We get a lot of the sales we see are out of county, if not out of state investors who come here because it's a good place to do business. And it's an easy place to do business. And Dallas is a good city and a good county.
I noticed with a lot of the downtown property, got a lot of investors from elsewhere.
Yes.
Who are coming in and investing heavily. According to Mr. Brown, the percentage change between FY12 and FY13 in terms of prior year, we're up positive this year at 1.69, which is like I said, last year was minus 3.6968. So, anyway, again, thank you for what you're doing.
One question, yes, sir. Our forms that we send to people when their property goes up in value, has it changed in any way this year?
No, it's 90% of the language in that form is mandated by the state, what we have to do on the form. We've added some things about electronic notices. We advertise the availability of that, but the rest of the form is pretty well standard.
Front page with the boxes on it that tells them what their property is out there.
Yes, that's the same.
Still the same.
Yep.
Thank you.
Let me say this. I said this last year, and I'll say it again. Without the support of the commissioners in Dallas County as a whole and Mr. Ann's office, we couldn't do the job we do. And I greatly appreciate that. And on behalf of myself and the board of directors, I'd like to thank you for all you do for us.
Thank you for bringing the good news. And Mr. Nolan, of course, you know, I want to thank you, you know, for all the work you do also with constituencies. You know, let's face it, sometimes your role is more than just overseeing the whole process, but to talk to some of the people that have problems with evaluations or, you know, don't know, sometimes how to get around the process and sometimes even include us. So we appreciate your work and definitely your commitment to Dallas County.
And we take care of that one email that you and I know so well.
Thank you. Judge, continuing briefing. Item 2, Health and Human Services. Item 2A, West Nile Virus, from Director Thompson.
Judge, we've mailed out to all our cities, and I want to commend the cities in Dallas County, the municipalities. They're taking our letter, the bill that's passed, inside County Government, SB 186, and they're posting on their website. But hundreds of emails I'm receiving, I'm forwarding them to their code enforcement, referring them to follow SB 186 and legally accessing those abandoned properties. So again, I'm still getting emails, but I forwarded it back to the Pacific municipality for them to follow up and utilize SB 186 as a caveat to make sure that they can enforce these abandoned properties immediately.
One of the things I really appreciate, we always talking about giving notice, I appreciate the way you handled that particular issue in one of our northern southern cities. When the public engages themselves and decide to get involved, it's just an imperative that they feel as though when they reach out to county and agencies, to a bureaucracy, that it's going to be some follow through. And that gentleman took the next step. I mean, he went over and beyond. And so I look forward to the follow-up with regards to that particular complaint. Because, as you know, those have been some of the same complaints we've had in the weatherization, that people, the cars, they're engaged and concerned about what's going on in their neighborhood. We find people who are, unfortunately, even in the north, living in houses either with insufficient electric or no electricity or trying to do without. So I just appreciate the way you follow through.
I appreciate them sending me this operation 24/7. And so we go to the next slide. All our negative reports from the cities, the no positives to date. You see all the cities that have reported the mosquito traps throughout Dallas County Public Health Lab. Next slide. You get our vendor update. That's the main thing in terms of weekly updates. I want to kind of let you know what's going on with BDCI in terms of traps, all been negative. Map vision, again, we're targeting June 3rd. So hopefully next week or right at the beginning of June, I'll give you an update on where we're going live. All right, insecticide resistance testing. I want to commend our staff, Dr. Perkins. It's a lot to be said and based on last year, but the top doctor, Dr. Perkins, he's visited the city of Houston. He's looked throughout the nation at best practices. And it's under his leadership that we began to look at the insecticide resistance testing. We did collect eggs in the jurisdictions of Dallas County. Have responsibility. I did follow up with the city of Dallas, but my expectation is that we do get samples from the city of Dallas. We think this is a critical part to make sure that this insecticide resistance testing gets Dallas countywide. And we'll go to the next slide. Again, these were trap data submitted doc in Dallas County. That's Dr. Perkins.
Thank you, Director Thompson. Good morning, Commissioners Court, citizens of Dallas County. This is the most recent West Nile surveillance report. I'd just like to go over those results as of May 11th on the total number of traps placed in Dallas County as of that date, 570, 356 number of pools tested, mosquito samples tested, that including the public health laboratory and the independent labs. For the independent labs, to date, they have a total of 5 positive pools. And again, the public health labs, we have 0. As far as the traps that were tested, there were on average 21 mosquitoes per trap. And to date, 6,219 mosquitoes have been screened for West Nile virus.
I think the last thing, if we go into the season, I know we were focused today on AWATCH, but also as we move into our summer, we run in parallel 2 things, West Nile Virus Watch and our summer heat program. So I'm going to caution our residents to also check on their seniors as we move into the summer heat. I don't want to miss that aspect because we run parallel response activities at HHS, and while we focus a lot on West Nile Virus, we prominent in our minds. Also, I want to remind our citizens to check on their neighbors as we move into these 90 degrees.
Well, primarily because we've had a number of heat-related deaths in the past. And that's what I was referring to a few minutes ago. But I think, again, sometimes some of the best indicators are people in the neighborhood and can check and see what's going on in the neighborhood.
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Thompson, first of all, you know, thank you for what you've done also for us as commissioners. Because for me to know how many traps, how many the letters that are sent to the municipalities, as an elected official, I go into different municipalities and meet with different elected officials. They find that your office has done a fantastic job keeping them involved and more than anything, knowing how many traps you're checking with them in other municipalities. So congratulations to you. And also I wanted to mention, it's a math vision, says here it will be ready by May 27th. Are we on track?
Well, I changed the date. I got May 27th, should be June 30th, where my target has been my earliest. So it's still on there. That's a misprint. My target is June 3rd to have that up and running with June 3rd. And I also want to thank you for posting our presentations on your website.
Well, believe it or not, I have a lot of comments about it. And I want to thank also Commissioner Price for the letter, for all the information that he also distributes to us from this committee, because that has been, you know, very informative. People understand now that thanks to Senator Corona and Honorable Giddings, you know, Bill SB-186, they're really, you know, getting, like someone mentioned, I think it was Commissioner Price, they involve, engage, into they can make a difference when it comes to education and reporting. So I get some of those, complaints as well, and I will direct it to you and, you know, to the municipality where they originate. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Zach, it may be beneficial to the court and the public, once you get that vision up, to do a public demonstration of that, to walk through and
right.
Do the whole thing.
Right. When we're going to go live on June 3rd, what I plan to do, I'll bring it forth to the court. We'll just walk through
a live demonstration.
We want to talk about the search request. We'll go with our preliminary startup. We're going to phase in some other things to the map vision. But the key point is that search request, and we want that to go live. The citizen can immediately send their search request. And so that's going to be the go live process.
But that brings up another issue, the one that I called you about 6 o'clock in the morning. And you transferred, I got the email back. The issue becomes, again, and talking to Ken from this whole bureaucracy. We called that city. That city contacted the homeowner and told the homeowner that was all well and good. However, that particular stream or area belongs to the Parks Department. And therefore now they're gonna give it to the Parks Department. And we'll probably take this up with public health. When people have got to go, and they just happen to be loud of it, when people have to go to more than one point, I mean, how with something like this, which is a public health, a nuisance, how are we not able to make sure They make one call and it does it all.
I want to follow up on that particular municipality, and I will. I want to be sure on that. And so I want to eliminate that. And so I'm trying to bring forward. Okay. I think on the map station, what that's going to give us is that real-time search report. And we'll be able to track it in terms of what is actually taking place in that municipality. So that'll give us that real-time lateral, but the follow-up will be done by our department to find out the status on it. So I'm going to work with them for the sake of, I don't want to have a comment.
I got it.
Well, I'm interested in seeing how far that tool went.
Yeah.
How far we can push that
tool. Yeah.
And it may address some commission process.
Yeah.
I think this tool is going to give us something that other cities can adopt, and I think it's a great tool.
Yeah, because the point is communication.
That's
and
it.
Getting the communication is easy to access and is usable by as many people. And regardless of where your entry point is, to have that available and clear and up to date.
And then we can document with that city that when we receive it, what's been the follow-up, and so we'll be able to get with that city. Some cities are still more challenging than others, but we're going to work on that particular city.
Thank you very much.
Item 2B recommends approval of the renewal of the interlocal agreement with the City of Cedar Hill and Dallas County Health and Human Services to perform the Cedar testing. Item 2C recommends approval of the MOU between Dallas County Public Health Preparedness Division and the AT&T Performing Arts Foundation for the foundation to serve as a close point of dispensation for prophylactic medicines to specific and pre-approved facility staff to assist recipients affected by a disaster or a public health emergency. Item 2D recommends approval of the MOU between Dallas County Public Health Preparedness Division and the University of North Texas System to serve as a close point and dispensation for prophylactic medicines to specific and pre-approved facility staff to assist recipients affected by a disaster or a public health emergency. Item 2E recommends approval of the award for FY 2013 for the Ryan White HIV AIDS Part A Formula Funds in the amount of $1,522,050 to serve providers. Item 2F recommends approval of the supplemental contract effective April 1, 2013 to July 31st, 2013 for the Comprehensive Energy Assistance Program. Commissioner, this item was in your formal agenda. Item 2G recommends approval of the FY 2013-2014 Weatherization Assistance Program contract with the Texas Department of Housing and Community Affairs, effective April 1, 2013 to March 31st, 2014. This item was also in your formal agenda. Item 3, Criminal Justice recommends approval of a permanent supportive housing project with the cottages at Hickory Crossing and requesting county fundings in the amount of $500,000 for year 2013, and the same amount for year 2014. Mr. Stretcher.
And I did have some folks, if I could take this to a minute and join me, and is that a big part of this?
Mr. Christopher.
And I'll let everyone introduce themselves. And these are all folks who have been involved in this project from the beginning. They're partners that are absolutely critical to bringing this thing together.
Commissioners, I'm Greg Christopher with Communities Foundation of Texas, also the home of the Belief Foundation at CFD.
And you guys really have been the drivers that kickstarted this and have provided
the $2.5 million, and we appreciate the Belief Foundation when it comes to education, health, and public safety. You all have been in the forefront. I still remember, you know, your hard work with the leadership program for the Dallas Police Department and the biggest donation of $15 million to that department. Christopher, it's good to see you. And definitely, it's a great project.
But I want to thank you. I want to thank you on another level. Yesterday, they published a report talking about poverty in the suburbs and its emerging. Communities Foundation tackled this some time ago. I remember being a part of that initiation, and you basically challenged us. I think what the report said on yesterday is that, unfortunately, it's not going away anytime soon. But I thank you for being a bit bold and getting out in front of the issue and trying to not just bring the issues to the forefront, but talking about resolution.
Solutions.
Yeah, solutions and resolutions. I'm still waiting with regards to, I think that it was called a tax credit. Somebody is supposed to be working on with regards to how they're doing it out of San Antonio, and that's still my challenge. I think I followed up with the letter. We're still waiting for that because that appears to be a way that we can help begin to ameliorate some of those concerns. But anyway, I just thank you for your leadership.
Thank you. And perseverance, as it's sticking to it, and it's not only checking off that you've started the process, but it's sticking with it and saying, okay, now let's get all of the partners together. Some will stray a little bit, but you say, come on, let's come back to the table. We have to finish this. And so I've been, first of all, impressed everybody that was able to come together in the first place, but then you stuck to it and you said, no, you can stray a little bit, but we got to finish it. And that's where perseverance should be noticed and appreciated.
I will just add, this is the 60th anniversary for Communities Foundation of Texas this year. We have been around a long time and working in this community in a lot of different ways. On this particular project, the cottages, this has been a collaborative effort now that has spanned many, many, many years. It has shown through lots of ups and downs over the time, but we mostly are behind the scenes. We try to be the wind beneath the wings of the folks who are actually doing the work. You know, there's a Roosevelt quote, though, that says the credit belongs to the man who's in the arena. And it's the partners of this project, it's the county and the city all coming together around the cottages that are actually going to make this work. And the credit goes to all the partners who are making this happen, and we're delighted to be a part of that. So thank you.
Thank you for the foundation.
Excuse me. Good morning, Judge, Commissioners. I'm John Burris. I'm the CEO of Metro Care Services here in Dallas.
Hello, CEO.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Rainbow, welcome. Loving it, right?
Indeed. Good morning. I'm Dr. Trevelli. I'm with UT Southwest.
Yes.
Yes, sir. And they're doing the evaluation component and have been excellent partners. My client has been involved in this from the start of the real driver.
Yeah.
And then for actually a lot of the work done, if you guys wouldn't mind standing, Lori P., Sandy Stevens, and Lindy Zimmerman. Lori is with Keaton Associates. Am I saying that right?
Lori
Keaton Associates. And it's been a tremendous help on getting our message out. And then Sandy and Lindsay are with Medical Care, and they've done a lot of the heavy lifting on documents and the work and keeping us moving. So thanks to everyone.
Thanks to all of you. And Judge, I just want to say at the end of the day, I think we've all come to the conclusion that this just makes not only good human sense, it makes good at the end of the day, it's good fiscal sense.
Yeah, these are our 50 highest utilizers to get out of the jail.
We have.
You know, this follows your earlier approval and endorsement of the NDHA PUP Permanent Supportive Housing Plan. This is 50 towards that. Right. And then this is critical to our process service project under 1115 waiver. There's going to be tremendous synergy out of this project. More than even the very positive benefits of the 50 that will be given. So
one of the things we do in BHLT is we try to identify what we call our highest utilizers, some people call them government's frequent flyers. And one of the things that happens in that, you may get 100 individuals that maybe you utilize as much as $7 million worth of a service out of it, just a few individuals. And so these 50 individuals will go a long way from the fiscal side of the house. Not only the right thing to do, it is definitely the right fiscal thing to do.
I think that's been one of the most gratifying things as we've worked on these various issues. Almost always, if you do the right thing properly, it also makes sense financially. And that's the beauty of that.
I'm sorry, please.
Oh, yeah, I want to say something about Ron Stretcher, because we're talking about this, and you guys back there are all great. Said something about how great you are. But one of the things that I strive for in life is to kind of stay calm and carry on. So I try not to get too much of an uneven keel on things. But I'll tell you, one of the things that freaked me out here in Dallas County, I looked down from the offices up there. I looked down one day, there's a meeting, and Ron Stretcher's in it with a bunch of people that are a little older than Ron. So I said to my staff, what's up with the meeting down there? They said, well, that's people looking at the option of retirement.
So I came downstairs and said, Ron, can I see you up in my office? And so Ron came up, I closed the door, I said, Ron, you cannot leave, okay? Because Ron's treasure is, he is a treasure for this county. On criminal justice issues, and on mental health care issues, on this Indian homeless issue.
IT issue.
IT, we got everything on Ron. Yeah.
Institutional memory.
Yeah, he is just a treasure, and he does so many things so well, and we are so fortunate to have him here. So,
I appreciate that. You know,
not a whole lot freaks me out, but you being in a retirement meeting, that kind of freaked me out.
It won't happen again. I have the advantage I've got the best job in the world. I get to do things that matter with people who care, with significant support from all of you. And so it makes every day a pleasure, and we're accomplishing a lot of things together.
Thank you, Mrs. One of the things that has impressed me so much about working with Dallas County is the ability to partner. And there is one person, there is an entity we partner with a lot, and that's the University of Texas at Dallas. So Dr. Scott, I recognize that you sat down, but that's one person who has, for about 25 years, been in the background, continually working with people and bringing information to the forefront, so that in fact we can work on projects like the cottages with good information, and seeing that the research is going to back us up. So thank you for all the partnering, and thank you, Dr. Scotch, for all the years that you have contributed to make all of us look there.
Well, and I just want to add that this project is, in particular, one of a kind. It's assertive community treatment. It's going to be the first on its kind when we're going to provide the services in house as well. And it's a team model that is going to be tested right here in Dallas County. So when it comes to all the programs that Commissioner Price, BHLT, that CJAP, when we see the serial inebriate program, that we have the challenge of providing these people, or the chronic fires, the housing, we haven't been able to do a lot of these programs because that's where we all stop. So it couldn't happen all of us are saying, without the collaborative effort of many organizations among them, and I want to read that because we couldn't do without them. City Square, Central Dallas Community Development Corporation, Dallas County Criminal Justice, Metro Dallas Homeless Alliance, Metro Care Services, UT Southwestern Center, among some of the organizations that are signing those memorandum of understanding saying that this is needed today. And we're making the difference. And of course, he's not here today, but I also want to thank Mr. Ryan Brown. At the time of the financing on how the county could participate, how to make it doable, feasible for us financially, he came to the table with Mr. Stretcher and put together, a plan that will make it work, colleagues. And, today, even when he's not here, I want to, commend, Ron and Mr. Brown on the Dallas County side for your leadership. And to all of you, our partners of many years that continue to make a difference in the founder putting those seed money when it really matters. Thank you all for being here. And we will continue to work with you. Thank you.
It's always dangerous to call because without sheriff and the public defender's office, helping us correlate those numbers and managing differently in such a way that we get the real numbers so that we can validate for our budget director and for this county and this taxpayers. And so again, I will continue to thank all of you. We've got a good team around this county. So,
Thank you.
Continue briefing. Item 4, Human Resources Civil Service. Request approval of medical plans available for employees' health care benefits in 2014.
Mr. We bring this proposal to the court today for final approval. And I am aware that it represents a major change for Dallas County and the way we deliver our insurance benefits to our employees. However, we recognized several years ago that our insurance program, the way we currently had it structured, just from a financial standpoint, whether or not we were going to be able to continue to afford it. One of the major programs was our EPO and EPO program, and we have in the proposal for you that you will see that is where the majority of our employees and where the majority of their dependents are is in the EPO program. About 3,500 of your employees are in that program, and then if you add about another 6,000 dependents, you will see that's where the majority of the employees and their dependents are in that program. And that is also where the majority of the cost for the program is generated. Our program is self-funded. So when we say the program costs between $62 to $63 million a year, that's the money that Dallas County actually pays out for claims and for administrative expenses related to our insurance program and processing of those claims. The PEVC, of which we are part of, and I have with me this morning the director of PEVC, and also we have your consultant with us from Tyra's Perry, who are here, Watson, almost did. Okay, who are here in case there are any questions. But they started looking at this probably over 18 to 24 months ago, starting to look at what are some possible options that the county might have in an effort, might take in an effort to control the rising cost of our program. Most employees last year saw an increase, but what employees don't know is that their premium increase represents a relatively small part of what the true increase for the program is. Each year, even when we were when our employees were not receiving a raise, the Commissioner's Court was still allocating anywhere from $2 to $3 million in an effort to keep the program affordable. So in an effort to look at how could we control that rising cost, the PVC, along with the consultant, started looking at options. And so one of the reasons why we're presenting this just has to do with the overall cost of our program. And it was probably put on the fast track with the Affordable Care Act and some of the things that are supposed to take place in 2018. One of the recommendations that was made by the PVC cooperative, and it was approved by the TGCW board, was to implement an account-based health plan. Quite frankly, a lot of people call that a high deductible plan. And that was one of the recommendations that they made. And we were okay with that recommendation. But one of the big things that came with that recommendation was that in order to implement it, we would be looking at the possibility of eliminating the EPO plan, again, which is where the majority of our employees are. There were a number of meetings held with the board, with Dallas County's employee benefits group. We briefed the court, Judge Jenkins, Commissioner Garcia are also on the board as well. And the conclusion is we came to the conclusion that to make a change really required one major decision, and that was when would that change take place. And we're here this morning with the recommendation based on information provided through the PVC cooperative, our consultant Tyra Watson, the Dallas County Employee Benefits Committee, were making a recommendation that Dallas County eliminate the EPO program and move to two insurance programs, one being an EPO program, the other one being the account-based health plan. And we've laid out the different, we've done different comparisons for you in the proposal. And we'll tell the court it's a major change.
It's going to require a lot of educating of our employees, and even then, so your telephones start ringing about unhappiness, it's not because we don't understand that unhappiness. But again, in an effort to make, to keep our program affordable, not only for the county, but also for our employees, and to comply with the upcoming full implementation of the Affordable Care Act, we make this recommendation to the Commissioner's Court this morning, and we ask that the court approve these two programs.
From a financial standpoint, I definitely understand the long term. We're going to spend the next several years trying to convey employees here. And there's nothing I've seen published, and maybe the consultants can talk about how we convey that to our employees in a very succinct way that talks about why we have to make this program. The investment of our annual $64 million related to their contribution needs to be generated in such a way that I guess that softens this whole EPO extinguishment. I'm just, needless to say, I'm definitely uncomfortable with it, but I know at the end of the day, in order to sustain the program, it's like what charge do we really have? I just don't see how we can sustain it any other way. I don't like the options. The options are this and nothing.
Just a couple of questions. With regards to our total amount spent, the $62 million was for what year?
That was an estimate from just our previous year. This year, 2013.
For 2013.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And what is your estimated cost for 2014 if this is adopted? Enhanced PPO and the HDHP.
Commissioner, I can tell you what's being put in the budget for the additional increase. What Ryan has pretty much done is look at allocating pretty much for this year, because we're still uncertain what's going to happen. He added an additional $2 million. He's recommended that we add, even this year, an additional $2 million to the county insurance.
Okay, so we're looking at $64 million for next year.
Approximately $64 million for next year.
Okay, and well, let me ask this question. Because of the Affordable Care Act, plans like Dallas County that are too rich are subject to an excise tax of 40%, 40% tax by 2018. So where does this put us in that? Frankly, in other words, do the employees need to understand this is just the first move of many moves to 2018 because of the Affordable Care Act?
And I
want full disclosure up front, so it's not, we're doing something this year and I was because we can't afford it. The Affordable Care Act is requiring us to move from where we're at right now by 2018.
By 2018.
Where it's going to be a lot of expenses picked up by the employee, and I don't want to sugarcoat that. I want to know exactly, so where does this, the enhanced PPO and the HDHP, put us as far as our relation of our plan to the Affordable Care Act and what we're going to be looking at on 2018?
And as you answer that, I think one thing that including your answer is, are the decisions that we're making primarily driven by the Affordable Care Act or the cost of insurance and trying to change the dynamic of how people make healthcare decisions?
Well, I can tell you this. By 2018, Dallas County is going to pay 40% excise tax for the plan that we have today. And we wouldn't, would find it hard to believe that we'd be transitioning our employees to a higher cost to them if it wasn't for the Affordable Care Act. But I'll certainly defer to the expert.
Well, good morning, Judge Jenkins and Commissioners. I'll try to answer your questions, but if you're off.
I just want to give your name for the record.
I'm sorry, Diane Conchadic. I'm the Executive Director of the EDC.
The EDC.
First, let me answer the question, is this change because of the Affordable Care Act or because of the cost of health care? I can tell you that I would say it's both. We initially started looking at this when the costs were creeping up, to the point where the sustainability was in question. And then, of course, the Affordable Care Act came along, and we've been in the midst of implementation of the Affordable Care Act for several years. You may remember when children up to age 26 were allowed to enroll in the plan, regardless of their employment or other coverage. We implemented 100% paid, employer-paid, and a self-funded plan, preventive care, which doesn't go away, and that increases costs. And so there are certain cost drivers that have been put into place already, and there are more to come. I'm not saying they're good or they're bad, but they are what they are. And what we know is coming, just like you mentioned, Commissioner, is a 40% excise tax in 2018. And it's the goal of all of the PVC groups and the PVC that that tax not be paid. And to do that, we have to take certain steps to make sure that the plans meet certain parameters that are being driven down by the Affordable Care Act, a minimum services type approach, so to speak. But you can't have it too rich, you can't have it too low. And so what this does with this option, it achieves two goals. The first goal is it gives you options, because the last thing you would want to hear, I'm sure, is for someone to sit in front of you in 2017 and tell you in 2018 the draconian changes that would have to take place in order to keep the plan sustainable. That's certainly not anything we're looking to do, which is why we started this project a couple of years ago. But starting in 2014, for those who enroll in the account-based health plan, there will be options. They can save funds for future expenses. That account part of the account-based health plan goes with the employee if they retire, if they terminate employment. And then the other thing it achieves is it still gives the option of a benefit plan with co-pays for those who simply just don't think they're capable, or, and I don't mean capable, but they just don't think it's right for them at this point in time. And I emphasize this point in time because those things can change as people become more familiar with the benefits of those types of plans. I can tell you that one of the provisions of the Affordable Care Act, we got new guidance on not long ago, was that in 2014, medical co-pays must count toward the out-of-pocket. For a self-funded plan like ours, prescription drug co-pays must count by 2015. Well, to try to reduce the amount of change as much as we can, we included in the enhanced PPO not only a slightly less deductible, but we also included that both medical and prescription drug co-pays will count toward meeting the out-of-pocket maximum to help people see how far and how long it takes to reach that amount. What it really achieves is that people are going to become more aware of how they're spending their healthcare dollars. Not so much if they need it or not, but how they're spending and their options. I want to also address, Mr. Price, your comment about the communications and how we educate. I have to tell you, that was probably the number one component of this entire project, was to find a way to roll this out and help educate people as to not only the benefits of the new plan, but what does healthcare reform mean to me as an individual or to my family or other resources I might tap into. So how to evaluate your benefit plan in general, and then looking at the enhanced PPO and the account-based healthcare plan to see which of them might be right at this point in time. So the communication piece is actually starting next week in terms of we've been formulating our project plan. Each group will be involved. There'll be lots of training sessions. lots of different types of communication medium, whether it be electronic, face-to-face, telephonic, internet, just as many opportunities as we can make available to Dallas County to help your employees understand. And not only a one-time shot, but repeated. And it's going to be part of a larger year-over-year-over-year education program, because this is not a one-year deal. We know that every year there's going to be some sort of modification somewhere as we march toward 2018. And then if there are things that change, we want to make sure that people have notice of what's coming so they have opportunities to learn.
I'm not sure you answered my question.
Sorry, I'm trying again.
Okay, there's a minimum and a maximum on 2018 for the excise tax. Where does this put us with the enhanced PPO and the HGHB? We're still above the maximum. So I'm asking, at what point do we get to 2018? So we're going to modify each year the PPO and the HGHB until we get to the point to where we don't have that 40% tax.
Right, and what's going to happen, Commissioner, is it's going to change in each of those years. Your costs will go up or down based on utilization. But when the actuaries project, every year we'll be measuring to see where are we in that continuum, starting with when this is adopted in 2014. And where are we, and what would it look like with basic assumptions? But we're not going to make any dramatic change until we get closer to see how far are we away from meeting that maximum plan. So for example, the healthcare spending account and the flexible spending account available to PPO members, this is not what's going to happen, I'm just illustrating. Those are considered medical plans under healthcare reform. So if you're close to exceeding the maximum, an adjustment to the amount of your maximum election in those plans in the following year would get you underneath. So what you have then is a sort of cushion that allows you to move up and down based on what your 2018 cost looks like. Keep in mind that you've got 4 years before that happens, 14, 15, 16, 17, 4 years truly before something like that should occur, which will allow those in that account-based plan to build up their reserve in the event they need to pay more of the public cost. But I can tell you that in today's world, if we were to measure it, today was 2018, we're just now gathering based on last year's costs and completing that. But I'm gonna point to Towers Watson for a moment. I'd say we're not that much below by adoption of this if tomorrow was 2018. But we now have time to get people's healthcare patterns changed before 2018.
They need to get healthier. But also, in order to get them healthier, what I want them to understand is that this is a process of cost shifting, and that cost is going to be shifted for the next 4 or 5 years.
Well, actually, the total cost, I'm just going to give you one illustration. The total cost is what we have to talk about, you said, not just the shift.
No, I don't understand. Right. Okay. Totally understand.
So the account-based health plan, for example, this is a very benign example, but if somebody knew they had to have an MRI and they were able to see an MRI at provider B would cost me $2,000, at provider C would cost me $1,000, at provider D would cost me $800. The cost of the plan hopefully would be $800 with the employee making the choice. It's the same MRI. I think I can get it at the $800 cost. You probably saw in the news, CMS releasing different hospital costs across the country. And I can tell you, as someone who used to contract at that end, you know, how people arrive at what the net cost is very different. And it was just kind of an eye-opener, I think, for a lot of people to see the wide variety of costs for the same services. Certainly geography has a lot to do with it, but even for the same MRI within the DFW area, or even Dallas County has a wide range of costs. So folks in the county's health plan will be able to see those costs if they choose. I would think they would want to do that because those are their dollars that they're going to be controlling. And be able to conserve some of that cost. And those choices are intended to bring the cost down. Whether or not they will do that in the first year, I don't.
I really want to see this communication plan. Because, you know, I mean, what the analogy you just used, what really caught my attention probably in less than 15, 20 seconds was the whole HIP analogy in this region, the difference in the cost, as you just made with the MRI. And so, I don't know, we're going to do some webcasts, that's part of the arsenal, and how we're going to get this, because this is like, this is going to take some real in-depth. This court took one afternoon for hours. We're still taking and pruning and still trying to generate through it. So I really want to see the communication plan.
Absolutely, Commissioner. And let me say, that's in its development right now. The first rush is going to be the county's health plan and how to use that and how to enroll and how to evaluate. This is not a one-year deal. The goal is to make sure people know where they can look, who they can call, how they can check, because it's the total cost that has to come down, not just the cost to the employee or the cost to the company. It's the total cost so that both shares reduce.
Right.
And the communication plan, like you mentioned, is critical of that.
I'd like to make the observation too that even to get to this point has taken many, 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 many hours from different people. And it was looking at the diversity within our set of employees also, so that one of the models that I found particularly illustrative was taking different scenarios of if you have an employee who is, you know, brings in $22,000 a year, what kind of an impact would the various options have on them, considering that there are still, as you've already noted, a number of items that we don't know yet. We don't know what the seed money is. We don't know what the premium structure is going to be. We don't know what some of those built-in costs are going to be yet. But we can look at what is the impact on a person, an employee of $28,000 with one child, if there's a catastrophic incident, or normal average healthcare needs. But being able to look at, you know, just in that, you know, 30 seconds, the number of factors that we talked about is kind of mind-boggling. But I would just like to say that we put in, at, up to this point, and I know that, as you say, we're not done yet on evaluating exactly where some of those items are going to be. What is going to be the seed money? What is going to be that premium structure? What are going to be some of the other national or state factors that impinge on each individual employee's situation? But that, I know what I've seen is just the great attention to the number of different employees, their family situations, their healthcare situations, and their abilities to have a say in those options. So it's a decision that none of us are taking very lightly by any stretch of the imagination, and I know that our representatives aren't either. We're midway point into it, but just the seriousness of this decision-making process is something that I think that we are all just so very, very, very much aware of. But so anything you can do to help in that communication.
I was just going to say the pinnacle, one of the things I still want to drive, and I understand that 22,000 people are hiring, and we can probably afford to make some different options. It doesn't impact us the same as it does where I think it's just 30% of our employees are, in terms of salary, it's 35,000 less.
That's right.
Okay. What concerns me, I still want to still continue to begin where we are. $62 million. And then, like you said, $2 million more than 64. That's just unsustainable going forward. Somebody supplement that. We're supplementing that. Taxpayers are supplementing. And I know they're concerned about what their contribution is. But at the same time, we're concerned about whether or not we can sustain $62 million, $64 million, yeah, $68 million. And what has that, you know, to try to give them some graph perspective, what has that done just over the last 10 years? Because they, I think is our average workforce 44 years, 45 years old, older workforce. That's considered an older workforce. That's considered an older workforce. And as such, we, you know, we're beginning to, we've been tracking, I know for years, you know, the number of incidents in terms of cancer, what I call very major kinds of hits to our bottom line. So I'm just saying, and I'm just throwing all of that out, like my colleagues, I'm just looking forward to the campaign in such a way that they can understand it, and it's got the and what we call, I guess, what you call rote memory, has got to be done over and over and over and over again until such time this kind of gets on.
I think Commissioner Press just hit the nail. It's about cost for everybody, not only for the municipalities and counties. The reality is the cost of helper has continued to grow. That the Affordable Care Act is a factor? Yes. Would it be the definite factor? No. We still have to go ahead and deliver quality healthcare to our employees. Now, nobody has changed, and I understand totally, heartily, that a lot of people are not going to be happy with the replacement of the MPO. We're going to have two opportunities. The first one, you know, probably not for everyone, but there are going to be two choices. And I think that the education campaign, one of the things that we talk in PVC and as Dallas County representatives, and by the way, let me thank Dr. Taylor and the judge, you know, because the three of us are the representatives in PVC. And to you, Ms. Conley, because you've been instrumental in giving us some of the videos, some of the information that is going to be reviewed. But at the end of the day, it's going to be of how does it affect me and how can I choose the best plan. And I have to say, Janet Pritchard, you know, as always, came and gave us a presentation that, you know, really pretty much tailored what your situation is to the plans. And as we discussed in PUC, when we took the final vote, I would like to that be part of the presentation, Commissioner. Not only what it is, the two different plans and the different aspects of the enhanced PPO, but also, you know, the base account. And that will, I think, will help us, you know, as an individuals to make the best choice. That is going to be easy? No. It's going to be a challenge for the rest of the year until we start in January 1st of next year. But I believe that, you know, we're getting ready. I understand it. We're starting this education campaign, Ms. Conabic, you know, within the next month. Yes. And the other thing I wanted to tell you, colleagues, you know, because not all of you were present at the final vote at PEBC, is that I believe that every single member of the PEC board has some concerns. You know, they ask extremely good questions as you have right now. And at the end of the day, it was a unanimous vote. So it shows that while we sometimes don't feel 100% comfortable with the changes, we all understand that change is coming and that we need to lower the cost for our employees and the institutions.
You know, Commissioner, I have to mention that not only has it been a unanimous vote for the PVC and absolutely all the hard decisions and all the hard work that went into that third part of this, but each of our groups has also unanimously approved it, and also with good questions and the same concerns that we all share. But I really want to thank attention to the board members that you mentioned. I also want to thank those that participated in our committee. Those folks spent days and days and hours outside that committee studying, learning. We've had experts come in from multiple sources talking to us. explaining, looking at case studies from other groups. We did an awful lot of work. Certainly, to my left, Gordon Kunkel and Dara Martin were involved, and Dr. Taylor. I thought there was somebody else. And Virginia Porter, Jana Butcher, certainly, who always brings challenges to us.
Yes, we appreciate that. It's a problem solved. We appreciate that.
And Tess McCall, and the Human Resources Department, who have, I have to say quite openly, have just been a remarkable resource for us lately and a remarkable partner, and we really appreciate that, as well as the Honors Office. So it's been a lot of hard work, but I have to tell you, it's not an easy decision, but we're very committed that people understand openly and honestly why, what would happen if we didn't take these steps, and you know, the impact of years to come. And just as you mentioned, Commissioner, how it would impact me is a key component.
Thank you. I also want to thank my chief of staff, which was part of this community.
Absolutely.
And I've got a couple of questions for you, if you know, and I don't want to put you on the spot, if you're the person that told me this. Last year, our number one drug was the purple pill Nexium. Do you know what our top three in real dollar cost drugs are?
You know, I don't have it with me today, Commissioner, but I can certainly provide that to you very easily. Okay.
Well, the takeaway from my perspective for our employees is this. The court feels a responsibility to you not to balance our budget on your back, all right? We recognize that our employees here make less money than they could in the public sector. And so there's always been richer benefits, the private sector, very important. There's always been richer benefits with government. And we want to make sure that our benefits are in line with the best plans of government throughout the state. And in that regard, we're looking at seeding these health savings accounts the first year. And I'm going to be pushing to seed those for just as much as we can so that we lessen the switch from our EPO to those. But there are things that we can all do as employees. Our number one drug in real cost last year, and I'm not telling anybody how to run their medical business, but our number one drug was Nexium, which is the purple pill for GERD, right?
For what?
For GERD, for acid reflux.
Yes, just acid reflux.
We all know, if we watch television, you know, we see regularly ads for new asthma drugs, heart drugs, and other drugs. When you have a health savings account that will help see, they'll have money in it where you can make choices. People may, as I have done, because some doctor years ago prescribed me the purple pill, and I found that the over-the-counter pill works just as well. I don't have much acid reflux, and if I take the cheapest over-the-counter pill, I'm fine. So there are opportunities for you to try that. If that doesn't work and you need the purple pill, get the purple pill. Absolutely. But what everybody is pushing for, Baylor Hospital, AT&T, private sector, I read an article on Humana's website yesterday to give the employees more control over their health care decisions. Like Dan's talking about with the MRI. And the best way for us to do that is to let you keep some of the money from your choices. If you choose something that is at a lower cost point, you're not just helping the taxpayers, you're also keeping some of the money. The hope is, because I agree with Commissioner Price, $64 million for less than 6,000 employees is not sustainable. The trajectory, when you look at those graphs, has that doubling in a pretty short time frame. We can't sustain that and do the things that we need to do for the community here. So we've got to figure out something, and putting you in a better position to control your health care costs and see a savings from that in your pocket that you can take with you when you leave these jobs, if you choose to, is one of the things that we're trying to accomplish in that.
Absolutely.
I'm going to go on record of saying that. And Judge, you're correct. The Affordable Care Act does put government sector, the public sector on the same footing the private sector now. Because the Affordable Care Act has taken away local control. They have established minimums and maximums. And so everybody's going to meet those, because I don't know of any governmental agency that can justify the 40% excise tax. So, but what I do want is for this court to be honest with our employees. Because of the Affordable Care Act, this is just the beginning of a period of transition to 2018, where you will be paying a considerable sum for your out-of-pocket and upfront costs, your deductibles. So, it's coming, and they need to be aware of that. So, and I haven't seen anywhere on the projections where the Affordable Care Act is resulting in savings on medical costs. Matter of fact, it shows just the opposite, but I would love to be proved wrong.
And that message comes to you from my beloved Republican colleague, who will be riding along with me if that's unfortunate to realize.
I'm just saying, I'm not going to sidestep and try to say it's because of the high cost of medical expenses that we're now making this transition. That's baloney. It's the Affordable Care Act. And so as employees see what comes down over the next 4 years, that's the driving factor in what's taking place.
No, regardless of which ideology any of us are coming from, I think bottom line, we are really sincerely working very diligently and hard at our employees and what each of the families will be paying in their health care, with the intent of decreasing the overall costs, as you said. But what's good for Dallas County is at the bottom of why all of us are here.
And the takeaway for our employees should be, we're going to do our dead level best to make sure you have the best health care plan of public sector employees that can be put together. And we're going to make sure that we do that in a way that is in the best interest of all the taxpayers who ultimately are paying for all of our salaries and all of our health care.
Thank you, Bush. I still have to see the best health care plan. As someone who deals with insurance, that's pretty gracious. I
have a way
to see it. Thank you, Ms.
Conley.
Thank you very much.
Judge Commissioners, item 5, Commission Technology, recommends approval of renewal of the Microsoft Enterprise Agreement with Microsoft Corporation. Item 6, Public Works, 6A, recommends approval of the tax foreclosure resale program to be administered by the Public Works Department. And the Honorable John Ames, elected colleague.
Good morning, Judge and Commissioners. I'd just like to say that we talked a lot today about partnering, and this project right here is a true partnership between the Public Works Department, the Tax Office, and our business partners, Linebarger, Robinson, and Texas. So we've got some people here in the audience today that have made this a true success, and I just want to recognize them. We've got some folks from Linebarger and Alberta Blair's staff have done an amazing job of making this a true partnership. So Lucilla and Pam have done an excellent job, and they deserve recognition for this being a successful program. In addition, there's been some input from other departments and some adjustments and procedures that have been made by the Sheriff's Department, District Court Purchasing Officer's Office, and the Civil DA's Office. And we wanted to say thank you for that.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Nicole, as well.
Item 6B recommends approval of the agreement authorizing the county to act as trustee City of DeSoto specific properties acquired via tax foreclosure. Item 7, budget 7A, conference travel, training requests. Item 7B recommends approval of the proposed reorganization of the Sheriff Department Data Management Unit to include the following four things. 1, deletion of 3 clerical assistants, grade 4 positions. 2, the addition of 1 assistant manager, grade G position. 3, the changes in title for each assistant manager position to first an assistant director of the intake and document imaging, and secondly an assistant director for release and warrant section, and 4, the reclassification of the data manager grade I position to director grade J, with the HR and Civil Service Department to review the classifications of the positions.
Did I get a signature sign on that submission? I'm looking for them back there. They,
I know we're saying.
Yeah, they didn't say anything. I got it. Okay.
Item 7C recommends the addition of the following five positions for the Health and Human Services Tuberculosis Prevention and Elimination Division, Department 5211. First, the three full-time disease intervention specialists, one grade CC, two, one grade manager, grade DD, and one outreach worker, grade 5. Again, the HR Civil Service Department to review the classifications of these positions. Judge Commissioners, including Monday's County Holiday Memorial Day, that concludes your briefing, and you have one registered speaker.
Is Pam, is that the new attorney there sitting next to you in the firm? I thought I saw her the other day. Is that the new attorney?
Yeah.
Okay. That's a door. We're glad to see that. Yeah. Line bar. Line bar. People, just stand up.
Would you please stand up?
Yeah, just stand up. Thank y'all very much.
I'm Pam Partner
Bridget Lopez. Would like to introduce their newest attorney, though, Isaac.
Yes, our newest attorney member to our staff is Isaac Foss, who comes from Washington, D.C., and joined us about 3-4 weeks ago.
From Oak Cliff, Texas.
Yes, coming back home. People can stay
Good to see you.
Thank you. Mr. Michael, I'm sorry, and I know you weren't talking on an email that I sent. Mr. Brown is also not here today. But I had a question about miscellaneous item 1B. The money for the grant is of courthouse allocated. I mean, I send that email. If you just can send me the response, I will be appreciated.
I will do that, Commissioner.
We still have a few items, you know, that I would like to ensure that if the funds are available, we can use it. Thank you.
All right, we have one registered speaker today. Will the board please read the rules of the court for our speaker?
All commissioners, court attendees are hereby advised that this meeting is conducted in accordance with the provision of Dallas County Code, Section 74-71. Visitors and registered speakers are to preserve all their improvement all the time. Personal, profane, or slanderous remarks are not appropriate and will not be allowed at any time during this public meeting. And any and all applauses be kept brief and observant of time constraint. Disruptive visitors or registered speakers may be removed or subject to penalty provided in the state of Texas Penal Code Section 38.13, 42.01, and 42.05. Registered individual speakers are limited to a maximum of 3 minutes, and the maximum discussion on any one topic is limited to 30 minutes.
And our first speaker today is Ms. Carolyn Ann Morris. Only speaker today. Is it?
Good morning. Long time waiting. But I appreciate it. It was a good discussion. My name is Carolyn Morris, 887 West Winter Green, Grove, Lancaster, Texas. I want to first thank my commissioner for District 3, Commissioner Hines, for our communication. Fortunately, I'm not going to address my personal issue, but issues that perhaps could help the next upcoming election, as well as hospitals and medical examiners, and how different things that are done within Dallas County. I am a resident of age. I'm very concerned about senior citizens. I am concerned about when they get old, what happens to them, who really care for them. I have a concern about calibrations to the elections, equipment that is located to each poll. Would like to request the court, if it is possible, to post calibrations, date, expiration dates, to each equipment that is used in early voting where there is electronic voting. Now I want to move quickly with the 3 minutes that I have back to seniors and senior citizens and people that are aging. If we all look around, look at the mirror, we will often see that our hair is gray. I think the highest medication that's out there that I have experienced is Cytoxan, which is for lupus, which costs well over $1,000 for a 30-day supply. There is no alternative for that medication. So there are other different medications that are out there that our senior citizens use and our seniors use that because of their age, it's not utilized. I would like to just say from experience, my brother passed away at the age of 64. There was no more treatment. It wasn't the matter of money, it wasn't a matter of funds, it was just basically the matter of not providing the medical services because of age. We will all get older, and we will all want the medical care. I would hate to think that we live in a world that will minimize the type of care, medical, that we will receive when we turn 60, 65, or 70, or even 80, that still have substantial time in life. So in saying all of that, I look like I have got down to the point of calibrations one more time. Please, if there is any control of this commissioner's court on each machine that is located in the area for election, to post the calibration date, expiration date, so individuals that are voting will know that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Bryce just sent us a communique about this. I have not been able to read it. Is some of these issues possible, Commissioner? And then we can discuss it further, but the answer is yes.
All right, and that takes us to our closed session. The court will now recess for this closed session. So I'm going to start chapter 551 of the Texas Government Code. Any action groups will have a closed session and take the next session. We'll begin our closed session.